Sorry, folks.
Okay,
okay,
I
hear
hear
myself,
myself,
Bobby.
Okay.
Now I hear myself twice.
Yeah. I think we're good. We're good.
Okay.
I think we're good. I can see everything's there. We should be coming through.
Yeah.
It okay.
Sounds normal now, I think.
You guys can't hear it. We're good.
I think we're okay.
I think we're okay, Bobby.
Good. I have no idea how that happened. I apologize way in advance, or a little bit delayed in that case. All right, I got a question for you. I've been thinking about this all damn day.
Okay.
I went and to grab a pen, and somehow in the midst of it was an old school mechanical pencil. I have not used a pencil in forever.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Why is 0.7 the superior lead over 0.5?
Well, because it has greater tensile strength than 0.5. So you can apply a bit more pressure on the page.
Yeah.
And with 0.5, me anyway, I got big dumb fingers, so I could never use a 0.5 without breaking the lead.
He's not delicate.
He's not delicate, no.
Not, no.
Do they make bigger than 0.7?
Mm-hmm.
This is 0.9, I think.
You do.
Or in like a number two pencil.
Right, there's...
Could I just get a 1?
This pencil right here, I believe.
I don't need 0.9. Give me my extra point.
Yeah, this uses 0.9 right here. I was just using this the other day when I hung up something on the wall.
Do you have a preferred style of writing implement? Like not just, oh, I prefer pens over pencils. Do you have like a type of pen that you
Pilot G2.
I'm a Pilot G2 fan. Yeah. I like those are all right.
I like a gel ink for sure. Yeah. There was a pen, and they ended up making a pencil from the 90s, Dr. Grip. Remember those?
Yep.
Look up a Dr. Grip pen really quick, Chase. It's got such a weird fucking look to it.
DR, or I spell out doctor?
It's DR. And it was like a black one. I think it came in red also. Being a big-handed guy.
I've never used one of these.
Oh, man. That right there, you give me a gel ink Dr. Grip, fuck me. That was such a, and I have not said Dr. Grip pen in probably 2 decades. I don't know how I pulled that out of my ass just now, but I did.
I'll tell you what I like are these, they're Staples brand. It's like the Staples OptiFlow, they're called.
Okay.
They just have a really fine point on them.
Nice.
And I have had the problem where they do eventually kind of explode on you, or they leak a little bit, and that sucks. But just like in the hand, like, oh, this feels great.
Yeah,
good hand feel.
Yeah, good hand
feel. Last question around. G2s are
good.
Good. Wide ruled, college ruled?
College. Fit more words.
College.
College? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Nice.
I'm too smart to use wide ruled. I went to a higher education place, and I will use their.
Oh, you, Greg Miller's alma mater, I believe.
Yes, sure. Yeah, that's the one. Me, John Hamm, and Greg Miller all hanging out together, and Brad Pitt was there for a little bit, and then he left.
Best friends
beforehand.
Best friends.
Like the four of us, we tore it up. Tell you what.
It is July the 5th. This is episode 332 of the Casual Hour. I am Bobby. Johnny and Chase are here. How are you two doing?
All right. Good. Everybody have a good Independence Day?
I did.
Independent?
I did. I was celebrating my independence by eating way too much food and introducing a friend of mine to the Righteous Gemstones.
Good. So,
nice.
Not a bad day.
Not a bad day.
I celebrated my independence by being independent. I was in my house alone. I was supposed to go to the lake and hang out with the folks, but that didn't work out because there was so much fucking rain and it ruined a bunch of plants.
There's a lot.
But your dad did stop by.
That was earlier in the week. Yes, he did.
Let me wash your car. Let me stay.
You know what? If he washed the car, probably would have been more justified.
Why are you going to be washing the car? Let me bring in your mail.
He just happened to be in the neighborhood.
Yeah,
happened like to be a good in the neighborhood
after the 2.5 hour drive because his phone didn't work. To give you the short version, his phone didn't work. And instead,
I'm sorry, that's such a sweet story.
My mom wasn't in town to be able to relay, hey, your dad's phone doesn't work. So he decided to drive 2+ hours. It's
basically to let you know he's okay.
Yeah, he's like, God. Hey, by the way, in case you were trying to text me, I was like, well, what? Why are you here?
Oh man, that's the most complicated solution to that problem, and I.
Jesus,
it's kind of sweet. Your dad sounds like a sweetheart.
He's very cool. I smoked some meat, hung out with family. My brother was out of town, so I got to go take his house for like 2 days. Swam, hung out, ate some pizza. It was a good time, man. Really nice. Nice. And got to see family, of course. That was the highlight of it. Well, and then I got to play some games. Oh.
Yeah. It was a cool one, too.
Neat.
He sent me a picture.
Yeah, I sent Bobby a picture later too. It's the for anybody who cares. It was the high grade Gundam Akalis from Witch from Mercury.
Listen, these late night GD picks Chase has been sending me real hot and too hot for TV.
You can't see him, but he's right there. He's there in the background.
And I applaud you for putting that much porn on Twitch. You've done a great job.
That's me.
We're going to be talking about some video games tonight, and we got some news to cover. There's been a lot happening. We're going to talk about Final Fantasy, AEW, Kingdom 80s, Bleak Sword, Dave the Diver, and a little game called Street Fighter 6. Maybe you've heard of it. So a lot of good reasons to hang out with us tonight. And Chase, I would love to know, what's your fantasy?
It's not playing Final Fantasy 16, I'll tell you that.
Damn,
that's not my fantasy. I put in a handful more hours. You're still probably way further than I am, but I am also way further than Johnny at this point, because he still.
I played some today.
No, you didn't. Don't lie to me.
You don't spell Street Fighter 6 FFXVI, Johnny.
I'm trying to think of where I am in a non-spoilery way.
How many icons do you have?
Still two. Just two. Then
I'm probably a little bit ahead of you, I bet.
We're going to the Oriflame. Oriflam?
Okay. You're not far.
We're going to the capital. Okay.
Yeah, you're not too far.
We've talked about this. We talked about it last week. We've talked about it off air. I think this game's boring. We were a little higher on it last week when it was our first impressions. But playing this game a little bit more, I think I'm ready to say it's just kind of boring. And it's not even a bad boring. It's just kind of a whatever. I don't know.
I think so. I laid it out to you today, Johnny. It's one of those things where I don't feel like I'm exploring much. The missions
there's nothing to explore. It's a game that is very waypointed, and the sections of areas, like it's not a big map, it's a bunch of segmented pieces, and they are all pretty straightforward. You cannot get lost, but you also cannot explore or do anything, and every time you do try to explore, to go off the beaten path to find a box with something in it, it's hey, here's 50 gil and a piece of crafting material that you're never going to care about, and like, oh wow, thanks, cool.
I just think it's also interesting that for a game that lets you enhance, like you can get new gear and shit, I still find myself approaching every battle the exact same way. The gear is not adding things in. It's like, oh, cool, I have unlocked like this element into it, or I've slotted this in. Like once you get your necklace and your ring, you're like, okay, I'm set. I got the stuff I want. Then you get your icon abilities and you're set. But you're going out and you're getting new gear, and it's just then at that point about making numbers go up versus making anything new or inventive. Like,
but you still approach it. It's even not that much about getting the numbers way up, because I still just don't feel like this is an RPG. In fact, the more I'm playing it, the less I feel it's an RPG.
It's God of War's more of an RPG.
Yes, absolutely. 100% is. I was talking to a coworker about that. He brought up, I played God of War Ragnarok, and he loves Final Fantasy more than any of the three of us, probably more than all three of us combined. And he's out here going like, it's not an RPG. It's like Ragnarok was way more like you were making more decisions about what your gear was and slotting things.
Yeah, and picking gems and shit to put into it. I
mean, it's... Here's the thing, though. Yes, it is boring, but it's also just extremely playable. It's very good. It's so accessible. I think if you are a person who hasn't played a Final Fantasy game before and are kind of interested in what you've seen, it's totally fine to just jump in. Don't expect any other Final Fantasy game to play like this, but it's totally fine to just jump in, treat it like a character action game, and you'll be fine. Put on some of the assists if you want to. They make the combat easier. I've put on a couple just because I kind of don't want to care. I just don't care. It's just let the game go. Let's just
almost get a on podcast this. Game.
Yeah, if there weren't so many goddamn cutscenes. Right. And the problem is the cutscenes are kind of the best part.
Oh yeah.
But I don't know. It's tough. I don't know if we've mentioned this on the last week podcast, but I think if I was to rank every Final Fantasy, this would be pretty near the bottom. But I also know that I will beat this one, where there are many other Final Fantasy games that I haven't beaten because, you know, it was too difficult at one point, or it was I didn't know where I was supposed to go next, or there was some other archaic mechanical bullshit that I didn't want to get into or didn't want to deal with. And this one, it's frictionless.
You can just go.
Yeah. But also being frictionless, there's just no tension to anything. You just kind of see the amusement park ride of it all. Of all right, I guess we're just going on this journey and we'll see what happens. I think also the journey's a little bit boring too. I don't want to spoil story stuff for anybody who's still into it relatively early, but there are some they would call them revelations that I would say is just the text of the story. Like you immediately know what happens, and then they hem and haw for a handful of hours to go like, did that really happen? And then eventually they realize, yes, no, that absolutely happened. That was the thing that happened. And then they spend another couple hours going, yeah, but did it really happen? And then after that, they're like, I guess it really happened. And I'm like, yeah, I've already known. I knew it happened from the moment it happened.
Yeah, it's a pretty poorly kept secret. But
it's very silly. And then they set up another secret, another thing of like, well, if that happened, then what's this? And I'm like, foreshadowed this so completely. There's no mystery to this. It's fine. Just let me play the fucking game. Fine.
I think it's pretty telling. Like, it's a good game. I'm having fun with it. It's boring as hell.
Yeah.
And I think it's pretty telling, not to put Johnny on the spot. Hey. Yeah. I think that you are arguably the biggest fan of the series on the show, and you are not even past the point where that, you're not even past where the demo end.
Yeah, I am.
Are you?
I think he is.
Yeah, okay. Like 2 hours past that, I think.
Regardless, you know what I'm saying.
Yeah, but also, I haven't, like, excluding the 7 remake, like, there hasn't been a Final Fantasy game that has really ensnared me since 10. So it's
10 more than me.
Yeah. It is interesting hearing some game reviewers and other people talk about this. Like, I've listened to Patrick Klepek on Remap talk about how he likes this game a lot because he likes the cutscenes and he likes the action. Mm-hmm. And I get that because he's not coming to it from a I like Final Fantasy point of view. He's coming to it from a I like character action game point of view. And that's fine. Again, like this is
it's not a bad game.
Definition. It's a totally serviceable Devil May Cry, Bayonetta. Like, it's not as good as either of those in terms of the action. But it is more those kinds of games than it is a Final Fantasy RPG.
Yeah, it's polished, it plays well. I think I don't know. Like, I haven't given it a fair enough shake.
Yeah. Because the things you're saying aren't wrong. Like, one of the things I've heard about games that I really like is that good games make you make interesting decisions. At the more interesting decisions you can make, the more interesting the game is. And when I play something like Final Fantasy VII Remake, there are decisions that you make on who you're playing at any one time. That's the party. It's like, okay, yeah. I want to be
Barret. Should because I heal now? Should I buff? Yeah, like, yep.
Totally. Like, who you want to use because they have the thing that counters this thing. But they are also weak to this other thing. So I need to be careful about switching and when I do things.
Right. Are you talking about Street Fighter right now?
Sure. Hey, that's a game. That's everything is an interesting decision. So I get it. But this game is especially early because you only have the one icon. And then even when you get the second icon abilities, because you don't have a party, it doesn't feel like interesting decisions are happening. You have some AI companions who just do stuff.
Yeah, I feel like I'm just watching these things happen. I have no agency in it.
And then even the icon abilities, it's okay, here's an ability that lets me do a bunch of damage in a single shot. Okay, I kind of know when I'm supposed to use that. And here's one for crowd control. Okay, I kind of know when I want to use that. And then I've gotten one that's like, okay, this is slightly better against making somebody stagger. Okay, cool. And then that's kind of it. It's just those three things in all the different abilities that you can get. And I just haven't found enough usefulness out of those things to feel like, oh, this is the ability I need to use now because I need to switch to that and do that thing and do this thing and do it in a sequence. And it's just kind of, well, it's almost like treating it more like an MMO because of all the cooldowns of, okay, I do this ability, then I do that ability, then I switch and then I do this ability and that ability, and now I wait. Now I wait until all those abilities come back, and then I do them all over again.
You know who? Okay. There is an RPG that does rely on cooldowns, but I think has a far superior combat system. Would you like to know what that is?
Sure.
Xenoblade Chronicles 3, baby.
Okay.
Game fucking slaps.
Yeah. I believe it.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah.
That's a really good point.
I mean, that game also is built and, like an MMO. Like, the whole point of Xenoblade games is they are like MMOs.
But also, MMO. I'm switching between characters. I'm figuring out when do I pop this ability. Yeah. Like, you know, it's a lot more involved. That's, like, I braced myself for that before I went into 16.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's one of the reasons I had such a, like, visceral reaction to 13 is because I went into it knowing relatively little, and I was like, wait a minute, where's my party? Like, what the fuck is going on? Why is this all just one straight path? And I'm not like exploring an area.
I really feel like it's like an MCU movie to me. And it's something it's fun. I watch them. I'm interested at a certain level, but I'm definitely not as engaged with it as I would be like The Dark Knight. And like The Dark Knight for me would be like 7, where I want to watch it. It's a masterpiece. I see all the acting and the performances and the plot, where some of these Marvel movies is like, well, I kind of feel like this is something entertaining. It's done well. There's great production to it. It's got some cool moments and sequences, but a lot of the stuff between it's just tolerable. And I feel like this is the Final Fantasy game you get in an MCU-centric universe where people are very much...
I see that. I get what you're saying, even though their inspiration was definitely more Game of Thrones, they've said that. But I think to your point, it is like this is a lot of just popcorn stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Even though they are trying to say big things about politics and all this stuff, it's like it all comes off as very shallow. And again, it's fine. It's just it's watchable and it's playable and it's OK.
Right.
But Johnny, to what you said about 13, I would like to have a visceral reaction to this game one way or the other. And seeing trailers and going, wow, they took out the party. It doesn't look or feel much like Final Fantasy from what I'm looking at. Like they must have done something really different and interesting here. And then they just kind of didn't. And it's just kind of a normal ass game that they put Final Fantasy 16 on. And that just leaves me feeling flat rather than, like, it, honestly, despite what you said, it makes me want to play 13 more. Because 13, I at least know I'm going to have some feelings about. And this one, I just don't have any feelings about.
Yeah. Yeah.
I have toyed with returning to 13 before, too, because I like... But then also I remember listening to Brad at Giant Bomb, like, after I played for 40 hours, like, Jesus Christ, man. Yeah. That's when it got good, after
also, 40 hours? And also, that's the first game. They made two more Final Fantasy 13s.
I mean, I'm going to see it through. This is not a bad game. It's boring, and I think you nailed it, Chase. That's like a really... It's boring, but fun.
Yeah, I think calling it an amusement park ride, which I did earlier, is just the perfect metaphor for it, because it is just you kind of sitting down, you going on this ride, and then eventually it just ends and you did it and it's done now. The people who are thinking about New Game Plusing this, you guys are insane people. What are you doing? Why are you wasting your life? I've done all of the side quests so far that have been available to me. None of them have done anything interesting. It has all been garbage rewards. There's some, I wouldn't call it story payoff. There is some flavor, lore, I wouldn't even say lore, just some like tone payoff of, the world and the characters here are interesting, and I see what they kind of want to tell you with that with this. But even then, those aren't even cutscenes. They're just snippets of dialogue that make you go, okay, yeah, I kind of see what's going on here from a character perspective. But they just aren't worth it. And I don't know. I did have a friend who has beaten the game tell me that it does get much more bombastic as you go on. It seems like there's a switch at one point where just they turn it up and it gets insane. And if it's just
that, where the PlayStations are melting?
I don't know if it's so much that it's doing a hardware issues, but it's just supposed to be that, okay, hey, they turned up the Final Fantasy dial and now things get really fucking nuts. And if it's just, okay, the amusement park ride now has crazier stuff going on around me, like, okay, that's a better amusement park ride than the one I'm on. But I imagine it's still going to be an amusement park ride where I'm just kind of sitting through it. And that, again, that's fine. I'll get through it. Will this be in my top 10? Probably not. I don't know. Maybe it'd be 10, but I don't.
Yeah.
It's not something that's going to stick with me. Codename Steam has stuck with me more than Final Fantasy 16 because I do have a visceral reaction to that game in that I think it is dog shit. But it's making me think about things in a way that Final Fantasy 16 is not. And honestly, this is probably the last time I'll talk about Final Fantasy 16 on the podcast. Even if I beat it, I guess when I beat it, I'll say, hey, I beat it. But unless that game does something to grab me and go, this is the thing you need to talk about, then I'm just going to stay on the ride and it'll be fine.
Fair.
That's fair.
Yeah.
That's Final Fantasy 16 update from the crew. Chase, what else you got going on?
If you want a visceral reaction to something, AEW Fight Forever is wild. It's good, it's bad, it's both. It's not boring, I'll tell you that.
I gotta tell you, man, I'm so disappointed. Not that you're playing it, but what I had to sit through on that fucking baked potato trying to play this game. I know that they were going for a throwback to the 64.
He's talking about the Nintendo Switch, ladies.
I know.
Yeah.
Chase, that about did me in. I about shut the shit down. I about had to stop it right there.
I think it's a good, so people will be able to watch our quick look and they'll be able to see an alternative to the mainstream consoles and see how a game like this runs on something like a Nintendo Switch.
You own a very high-end gaming computer, and this game is available. I can't take that
with me.
On the PC, you own a Steam Deck.
You have a Steam Deck.
You should have led with the Steam Deck. I have no good answer against the Steam Deck.
It is playable on the Steam Deck.
It is. I'm sure it's extremely playable on the Steam Deck.
It's whatever.
I like the Switch. I don't know what to tell you. I like having something in the hand and immediately being able to dock it and then have it go on the TV and it all just kind of works. And the Steam Deck can do all of those things, but it does it in a clunkier way that gets you better performance for sure. But it doesn't just work in the way that the Nintendo console does. Now, when it does work on the Nintendo console, it still looks like shit, but it does
ran
work.
Like shit, dude. That thing glitched and hung up so much. It was like a,
done in a way that mattered.
I don't know, dude. That was some like, it's like when you got one shopping wheel that just gets stuck on a rock.
The resolution certainly
I didn't even know this game was coming to the Switch.
I didn't either.
Coming to all your favorite consoles is what they said on AEW program.
I just gotta say, like, my rocketing pride in the moment. Chase, like, oh, guess what? I'm using my capture card. I'm like, fuck yeah, Chase, way to go. And then he goes, but it's my Switch, and I immediately just fucking tanked. I've never flown so close to the sun.
It was only also to be so burned much easier to get my Switch into the capture card than anything else, because all of the other consoles are over here and I have to put like an HDMI cable that's really long. The Switch, I have like an alternate thing that I can just plug in and the Switch works right in there. Anyway, that doesn't matter. AEW Fight Forever, it's a wrestling game for AEW, All Elite Wrestling, which is kind of an alternative brand to WWE. It's got a bunch of previous WWE talent and a bunch of new guys and some indie guys, and they've come together to make this new wrestling program, and it's going on since 2019, and I think it's relatively good. I've kind of slowed down in my wrestling watching generally, but I would probably watch AEW before I watch WWE at this point. The game itself, they've kind of been trying to go for a nostalgia play on here, where they wanted, when AEW announced this game, they're like, we're going to take it back to the Nintendo 64. Those were the wrestling games we liked. And everyone went, yeah, those are the good ones. We like too. Yeah. Cool. Yeah. The Aki games, your WWE, or WCW NWO No Mercy, or Revenge, your WWF No Mercies, your WrestleMania 2000s. So those are the good ones. Yes, let's do that. And then they hired Yuke's, which is a famous developer, or an infamous developer of wrestling games. They didn't make the Aki games. Aki did. Yuke's made the ones after Aki that were all on the PlayStation and after that, which had their audience, but weren't the N64. No. Famously were not the N64 games that everyone loved. So it's weird that you kind of went with that developer. Now, the story was that Yuke's developed the WWE games for a very long time, and apparently they always brought new ideas of things they wanted to do with the license, and look at how we could change the game and do it this way. And according to them, WWE was always like, make the game that sells, fine. Oh, like, we don't care about improving the game, just make the game again. Put the new people in it, make the graphics 5% better, and we'll slap $60 on it again, which is what they just kept doing. And so finally, when they cut Yuke's away and put somebody else on, I don't even know who makes the WWE games anymore. They all kind of suck. So now Yuke's is free. So the idea is like, oh, Yuke's is going to get all their great ideas that WWE never let them do, and they're going to make the AEW game that we've always dreamed of. And that's what we got. We got AEW Fight Forever. And I think the criticism that I've heard people say is pretty valid. In one, that it's not enough like the N64 games, but also it's too much like the N64 games. And it's in this weird no man's land where
it doesn't fit in anywhere.
It's uncanny valley.
Yeah, I mean, that's more on how it looks, though. And I think
not only that, just like the theory of it, like it feels very close to being real, but there's something that happens that distorts it to where it's no longer, it's just uncanny. Like it feels very uncanny compared to the other stuff.
Yeah, I suppose that's true. I'm having a decent time with it. I think the roster is pretty small, surprisingly small. AEW has a lot of really cool talent that they could put in here. And to be fair, they put in some sleeper picks that I didn't dream they would ever put in. A female wrestler that I really like named Yuka Sakazaki, who does not wrestle in AEW a bunch. She did kind of early in AEW and then went back to Japan for a bunch of stuff and doesn't show up all that often. Damn. She was always one of my favorites. She's got like a little magic genie thing going on. And she's great. She's just so good. She's in here as like one of the handful of women wrestlers that are in there. I'm like, holy shit, she shouldn't be here. I love that though. But then, Claudio Castagnoli isn't there. You might know him better as Cesaro in WWE when he was there. He's a big player in AEW all the time now, and he's not in there. But maybe, you know, that's
maybe DLC.
Sure, and they've already been doing DLC, and they're asking you to pay for the privilege. So, yeah, that's happening. I'm sure that's part of their plan. So the roster, I think, is fine. Overall, I think it's okay. The match types seem to be there. You can do your ladder matches. You can do your they wouldn't call them a Royal Rumble because that's a WWE term, but they have their casino battle royales. They have all the kinds of modes that you'd want in there. And it does generally play like the N64 games where you have grapples, you have strikes.
Can you reach into the crowd and get a chair?
I think or some you other can. Item? I think you can. I know when I created a character, we'll get to the creative character. But when I created a character, they did say, what is your preferred weapon? And I put bat, but you had a number of options there. And I imagine if it's like how No Mercy worked, because you also kind of did that in No Mercy. When you reach out into the crowd, you bring out something like that. It might be out from the crowd or it might be out from under the ring. I haven't tried actually getting weapons yet. So it has your strikes. It has that stuff. You can run, you can change who you're focusing on for your moves. That all kind of works like the N64 games. It tries to have some extra stuff in there where there's like some grapples that you can do light strikes out of, instead of doing, you know, suplexes and things like that, you can just do regular kind of moves out of it. So it tries to expand the number of moves that you have, and it generally works. I mean, you have two more face buttons on this controller than you did on the N64. So I guess it makes sense to take advantage of that real estate by having those buttons do more things. The problem is, while it does generally play like the N64 games, AEW, the promotion itself, does not wrestle like those games would want you to wrestle like. Like, AEW has a lot of guys who are small and fluid and fast, and they're jumping around and they're like bouncing off ropes, and they're doing high flying shit, and it's very all acrobatic. Very fluid. Yeah, very acrobatic, very fluid. Not everybody does that, but there is so much in there. And when you come into this game and it, like, do you want to play as Darby Allin, who's like a tiny little guy who skateboards to the ring and does like big jumps off of shit and is just like an insane person who I love. He wrestles basically like everybody else, where he's got his regular grapples and his strong grapples and his signature move and his special move. And it's like, that is not how AEW feels. It is how the N64 game feels. And if that's what you're looking for out of this, you kind of get it. But if you want to play the N64 games, you should probably just play the N64 games, and you could create a bunch of characters that look like the new AEW guys in there. And you're probably fine. I don't know. It's okay. The best and worst thing that I've played so far, and you'll get to see it in the quick look, cause this is what we mainly focus on, is the Road to the Elite, I think is what they're calling it. That mode is similar to like the NBA 2K modes or your Road to the Show in MLB The Show. You can either choose a wrestler that's already existing, or you can create your own character, and then you go through this story mode campaign that is loosely based on the history of AEW. It's very silly. The writing is very dumb. There is only voice acting from the announcers, and even that is very scant. And also, the voice acting is so flat. Jim Ross is in there. Jim Ross is in this game.
He's there.
And he will just unaffectedly talk about just zero like intensity to any of the things he's saying, and this will be a barn burner of a match. Like, wow, Jim, you didn't want to give like a second take to that. Like I've heard you be excited many times in the past. You didn't want to throw a little mustard on this one. No, none of that.
None of it.
Why would he?
But you know, I think the writing is dumb enough. The situations that they do are dumb enough. It's kind of like a Persona game almost, in that you have like your big moments. You know how in Persona you would have, okay, we know that this day we have to go into the dungeon, or in Persona 4, it's like this day we know the fog comes in and somebody will die. So we have to get all of our shit done before that day. And so they tell you, okay, you're wrestling on dynamite on this day. So now you have 4 days or four turns to get all of your S-Link shit up and figured out before you move into the actual wrestling part. So you get a number of options. Do you want to go out to dinner? Do you want to do a fan meet and greet? Do you want to work out and work on your stats a little bit more? And all of these things give you different bonuses to your energy or to your stats or to your relationships with other wrestlers and other people. And
God.
It's very dumb. It's so dumb. The first thing we did, it's in the quick look. It's amazing. We were in Washington, D.C., and it's what do you want to do? And Bobby's like, let's go out. Let's go hang out and let's see the sights. And
the sights we saw.
They take us to a stock image of the Lincoln Memorial. And then we see... We see Pac, who is a British wrestler, who's like a short gremlin looking man. I love Pac, by the way.
He was something on here, Chase.
I mean, he looked even more gremlin-y with the low resolution of the Nintendo Switch version. But he's normally like a weird gremlin dude. And he's your character's like, Pac, what are you doing here? You don't care about American history. You're British. And he's like, I might be a bastard. And again, there's no voice acting. So this is me putting extra stuff into it. He's like, I might be a bastard, but, you know, I still care about history more than you American idiot or whatever. And it's so good. It's so good. Oh, you man. End up taking a photo with him, and then you can go to your photo album and see the photo of your created character in Pac with fucking Abraham Lincoln in the background. It's so stupid and I love it. It's great. Oh, it's God. So great. I will give them a little bit of credit. I'm about done, by the way. I'll give them a little bit of credit in that I feel like they not even feel they've proven they are taking stuff from the story mode and not procedurally generating it exactly, but they're taking flags, like story flags, and they're incorporating that into future events. So in the very first match, they do this casino battle royale. It's like a big 50 man Royal Rumble, more or less. And your character gets in there, and I drew card two, so I was the second person in there. I wonder if two is just what you get because they don't want you to win the whole thing. But I drew number two, and I was in there with Christian Cage. If you like WWE, who is part of Edge and Christian, iconic tag team. So now he's here. He's Christian Cage, and he was in the match with me with some other guys, and I knocked him out first. He was the first guy I knocked out. Great. He wasn't in AEW at the time of that actual match happening, so don't worry about the story historical shit that's going on. But yes, I beat Christian Cage in that match. And then later in my very first match at Dynamite, after, you know, I visited the Lincoln Memorial and I got some wine and pizza, although they didn't show the pizza because they're cowards. They did. After, Bobby. It's in like a stock photo. Yeah. You don't get to see like the model of the pizza. It's like, that's hey, this is the pizza that you ate. And I'm like, wow, this game's great.
It's not.
So then we go to Dynamite and my opponent is Christian Cage. And I even asked Bobby on the quick look, I was talking about how, oh, I wonder if they picked Christian Cage because he was the guy I knocked out, or if they picked Christian Cage because that was just whatever the randomness hit. And before the match, he even comes up to you at one point and says, hey, you know, it's something like, yeah, these two have history because they were both in the casino battle royale and one knocked out the other.
Yeah.
And I'm like, wow, the game accounted for that. That's kind of cool. It's actually building storylines rather than just putting me in a bunch of matches. And I think that's a really neat idea. Totally. And it's cool that it's paying some of that stuff off. That has been in wrestling games in the past, but I didn't expect it to be here, and it was a nice little touch. The create a character, I think, is pretty bad. I don't think you can make anybody who looks very good. My character certainly doesn't look anything like me, which, you know, is good. I'm not saying I look like a person who needs to be in a wrestler, but I didn't like their options. I don't think they have enough face options. Yeah. I don't think they have enough hair options. Well, I think they have hair one options hair. That are there are pretty bad.
The Does it look like N64 hair is out there going for?
Yes. Not as good as N64 hair. Like N64 hair, I mean, it has more polygons to it, but I think it makes the hair look shittier overall. Because it isn't just like painted on to the face. It's modeled, but it's modeled like shit.
Yes.
And they don't let you wear a shirt. Like you're like none of your characters wear a shirt as ring gear. Like you can wear shirts. It's like, oh, what do you want your out of ring gear to look like? And oh, yeah, I can put on shirts now. But if I'm wrestling, I can't wrestle in a shirt. There's like you can wrestle in a bodysuit. You can do like full body wear, but it doesn't just say T-shirt. I can't just have a guy wear a T-shirt, which is weird because a lot of guys in AEW wear fucking shirts when they're wrestling. Yeah. It's very odd. The move stuff is all there. It is just as dense and silly as No Mercy ever was. And I loved the No Mercy character creator where here's like a bunch of super context sensitive moves that you will never really ever see in a match. But you got to know whether you do the drop kick or whether you do the double axe handle on this guy. And of course, you have to do all the greebly. I need this. I need that move. Oh, my character wouldn't do this. He would do a baseball slide instead. It's very silly and I like it. So overall, I don't think it's a very good game. If you're looking to play the N64 games, I think you should probably just play the N64 games. This is still better than pretty much any WWE game that's come out in the last decade plus.
That's not saying much, though.
That's not saying much at all. I'm probably going to still keep playing it because I think there is some very funny, and I think it's intentionally funny, shit in there, especially in the Road to the Elite stuff. But I don't think it's good. I can't recommend it, but I can say that I'm having fun with it, and maybe that's the most important thing. I don't know. Yeah. It's a weird one. It's a weird one. I would say probably don't get it on the Switch.
I would agree.
If you're gonna play it, probably get it on something else. But also, You don't need it. You don't need it. It's fine. Go back and play the Aki games. Those are way better. And Sting and Chris Jericho are in WCW NWO Revenge. You don't need to play them in AEW Fight Forever. You can already play them in a better game that came out 20 years ago.
Fair. Yeah. All right, Chase. We had a lengthy discussion on Final Fantasy and a lengthier conversation on Fight Forever. Anything else that you've had going on to update us?
No, that's it.
Okay. Well, Final Fantasy, we'll let you know when Chase beats it. AEW, we have a quick look coming up for that. So if you want to see it in action, we've got some good stuff to show you on that on our YouTube channel. I've got two new games to talk to you all about. You've seen them in some capacity, but the first one up is Kingdom 80s. This is from Fury Studios. That is $12, currently on sale. You guys have seen the Kingdom series before, right? You got Kingdom, you've got Kingdom Two Crowns. It's been on.
I didn't remember these games at all until you showed me this one. And even then, like there's like a camp, like a summer camp horror game that reminds me of this, where it's like all on one plane with like the parallax scrolling stuff behind. But I don't think I've ever seen this series before.
Yeah. It's a one-off from that. It's meant to be a smaller one. Was it Blood Dragon? That was a Far Cry, like the 80s kind of one shoot of that. So this is essentially the Blood Dragon, in my opinion, for the Kingdom series. It's much shorter than what you get with that. But the gist of what you're doing is the same. It's a tower defense game at its core. And you are in a beautiful pixelated world where you're going and recruiting people to come back to your base that you can assign to be builders or to be archers, and that can expand out further. At night, you're getting these creatures coming to attack your base while you're still trying to go out and recruit more people to help out with it. It's very simple in its execution. It's gorgeous. The 80s setting is really fun. It's definitely referencing like E.T., Stranger Things, Goonies, Spielberg era stuff from that period. It's just fun, man. It's a really clever take on base building. It's a 2D side scroller on that, and it's resource management to a degree. And I think the Kingdom games, which I haven't played as much as this one, are way more like intense, and it's very medieval and what you're doing there. But it seems like your shit, Johnny. Chase, I think you'll probably dig it as well.
Mm-hmm.
This is, the other ones are even on mobile, but this is going to have touch interface. Like you can, on the Ally, I can completely play this game using touch only, which is cool. Yeah, so there's a lot of fun stuff with it. It's really well done. $12 currently on sale for like 11 and some change. We're going to do a quick look on it here soon and let you all get your eyes on it, but definitely worth checking out for sure.
Very pretty water, like the water effects that they have and the reflection stuff and the parallax scrolling. It's a looker for sure. I was very impressed. So definitely go check out the quick look once we make it, because that's one that I think you should see for sure.
I'm still playing a ton of Nova Lands. That game continues to rule. I've got 7 islands and it's wild. I streamed it. You can go watch that. But what I've been spending most of my time with is this fucking out of nowhere hit across the board, which is Dave the Diver. You've probably been under a rock at this point. This thing is getting incredibly high remarks. It just hit 1.0. This is also a 2D beautiful pixel art game that has one of the most wildly different but incredibly smart gaming loops. And you play as just this endearing, lovable character named Dave. He's just a great boy, just a fucking avid.
Let him catch your fish.
He's gonna be already in the ocean. Let him get your fish. And then let him make it sushi. That's the gimmick here. You are diving into the ocean, and on the surface, you have a boat that gets you all your gear. You go below the surface. You now have this beautiful ocean that you have a harpoon gun, and you are collecting fish. And they have different weights and sizes and rarities, and you bring them back up to the boat, and they're like, okay, we're going to take them to the sushi restaurant. And they've got basically overcooked built into this game, where you are going into a restaurant and it's a whole RPG. You're upgrading its look. You're managing basically an Instagram account to get people to come and like enjoy your food. You can hire wait staff and basically train them and increase their stats and unlock new skills. It's fucking amazing. But then you're learning about the menu. Oh, I caught this eel or this jellyfish or this tuna, and you're learning about the preparation into sushi. And you're like learning what the menu does and how you can increase it and make people happier with it. You'll have one-off like VIPs that come in, and that's how you level up. So you've got like bosses underwater that you're physically fighting. And then you've got customers that are bosses that require an incredibly rare dish.
Is it just the critic from Ratatouille?
It's exactly that. Like the first, there's one person who's like, they got in touch with their childhood from this dish you made. And then you find out their father's been missing in the ocean, and it unlocks a quest where basically you can go and find her father from this whole thing that happened in the restaurant. But then it gets really fucking bizarre, like down underwater, because you're going
on a mission. Weird stuff happening in this game. I'm only in chapter one, but there's some high strangeness afoot.
Dave the Diver, by the way, it just hit 1.0 as we were talking about. This is made by I believe Mint Rocket. You can buy this game for $20. It's on sale now for $17.99. And Chase, I come to you not only to hype this game up, but to share a tweet from the developer that this game will be coming to the Switch in 2023.
Beautiful. Because right now it is only on PC and Mac, I guess. It does have Mac versions. But and that is, I know that's not a downside for you guys, but that is the only downside to me of like this feels like a game I would like to take on the go with me. And I know I have a Steam Deck.
You have a Steam Deck.
I do have a Steam
Deck. That is the only place I played it.
It seems good. It seems really cool. Yes. Like it reminds me a little bit of the first SteamWorld dig in that you just you would kind of go down into this thing and you'd find your stuff and you'd go back up and you'd and then you'd sell it. But then, like Bobby said, it is kind of overcooked. It is kind of like if you want to go really far back, it's kind of like Tapper or root beer Tapper.
Yeah.
Where it's just, hey, it's you gotta get these dishes to the right people. But I like just all the layers of stuff. Like, I don't think you can ever really get bored in this game because you're always moving on to the next mechanic.
Yeah.
It seems really cool.
That also has the combat. You're getting a whole weapon tree that you can upgrade. One of the other things is that this game keeps delivering. So it's also got two other sub mini games in it. And it's basically card rarities. Like there's on Cardboard Kings or in Magic the Gathering, like fish that you're basically building out a card library of the fish you get. And they do like, oh, wow, you found a hologram level fish that run like a really good version of the fish that you could capture. And then it upgrades your card. It's just so fucking cool how they do that. And then the other piece of it, as you're going to explore these things and do more underwater, eventually you encounter a VIP that has a farm, like a fish farm. And so when you're down, if you capture a fish, you get its roe. And then that goes to the farm. And then you are now able to just harvest your own fish that way. So you can go and just explore the ocean, do these side quests, and then have your fish for the restaurant just at a clip right there, which is really cool.
It almost adds like some clicker elements to it. Yeah. That's neat.
It's
automation.
It's one of the most inventive fucking games.
Yeah. It's a factory game is what you're saying.
Fish.
I understand why Bobby likes this factory game.
I love this game so much. In a year that I've had incredibly high highs, it's nice to have something that I just did not even think about playing, have on my radar, come in and just make such an impact.
And also, like, the incredibly high highs have been from the biggest games of the year. Like, the ones you expected to be big. Like, Zelda came out. Diablo 4 came out. Like, these are games that you kind of expected, oh, this is the one that's going to knock my socks off. And for you, they absolutely have. And you know, at least in terms of Zelda, that has for me. But to have, this is the stuff I like the best. Like, when I talk about, when we've done E3 predictions and my hope, like our wish list, and my hopes always, oh, I just want to see something cool that I never even saw before. I want to be surprised and I want a cool thing. These smaller indie titles that just kind of come out with very little prior knowledge. Not that they don't come out with fanfare, but there's no like preview of somebody's been talking about this game for months or years or whatever. Like you get with all this buildup with something like Final Fantasy 16. So for something to just come out and you play it and you go, holy shit, I didn't know this thing existed. And it's really cool. That is just one of the most exciting times for video games.
So good, dude. Yeah. That's
really great to hear.
It's awesome. I've put several hours into it. I'm about 15% of the achievements or 33% of the achievements knocked out. It's great, man. This game is also, it's got over 20,000 reviews on Steam and it's overwhelmingly positive. Not that that's the only thing to pay attention to, but it's just really special. So
people have spoken.
Yeah. Dave is a very good boy and the game is just so fucking fun. That's what I've been up to. So that's Kingdom 80s and Dave the Diver. A very inexpensive pickup this week from my recommendations. So definitely look into it if you have a means to do so. Johnny, you've been playing some Dave the Diver with me. I'm happy to hear that. Anything else that's been occupying your time?
I made it to bronze in Street Fighter 6.
Oh, boy.
But you made it to silver in Magic the Gathering Arena.
I did. I made it silver with my Nazgul deck, but we don't need to talk about that.
It has gotten so bad on both fronts because he just sends me texts or G-chats all day of being like, hey, I'm in Bronze 3 and I now have to think, oh, is this Bronze 3 for Magic or is this Bronze 3 for the fighting game? And whenever he says it's for the fighting game, it makes me a little sad. But
why? The game is incredible.
Yeah, but I'd rather you be playing Magic.
I've been playing a lot of Magic last couple
years. You certainly have, yeah.
Yeah, I Dave the Diver rules, first of all. I'm going to play some of that after the podcast.
It's while I'm so laying good. In
bed. I know I've talked about Street Fighter VI a couple times, but I had a goal for myself to make it out of Iron Rank and into like the bronze, silver, also, gold.
I think since the last time we talked on the podcast about it, you've switched your main.
Oh yeah, that's true.
I'm maining Ken now.
Wow. Threw Cammy to the side.
I played with some Cammy today.
It's like the Toy Story gif. I don't want to play with you anymore.
I know.
Wow.
You know what? It was the right decision because my win rate with Ken is like 12% more higher than what it was with Cammy. And I made it to bronze with like
GG.
Are
you sponsored yet?
Bronze. That's the highest tier, right?
It is. Yeah.
Yeah. It's as high they've never made anything higher than bronze.
No, there are five levels.
It's the most precious of medals.
Every rank. And I made it from rookie 4, I think, is what I got with Ken through the placement. Through iron 1 through 5, and then now I'm bronze 1. And I achieved that goal. I might set that game aside for a little while and focus on some other things.
Okay, I'll believe it when I see it.
We'll see.
Did you play 0.3 hours more of that game, Johnny?
I did. I'm at 69.6 hours.
Awesome.
69.7. Nice. And then lastly, I picked up a couple things today on the Steam sale. I went through my wish list this morning. What's on sale?
I fixed our title on the stream of what we're talking about.
Nice, well done. Cool. I mean, it's a day that ends with Y, so there's a Steam sale going on.
Mm-hmm.
What'd you buy on the Steam
sale?
Well,
this is the big Steam summer sale.
Yeah, this is the big one.
Right. I'm sorry. It's a it's a different day that ends in Y, so it's
even
time
more
for the big sale on Steam.
So I picked up a few games. I got a game called Other War, which is like a tower defense bullet hell game. I saw on Twitter a couple months ago. I haven't played it yet. And I picked up another game called Songs of Conquest, which has been on my wish list for a while. And it's still in early access. I don't know when it's supposed to hit 1.0. But sitting there very positive, has good reviews. And I think it's a fine game. I played it for an hour earlier, and I ended up returning it because I'm like, you know what? There are too many other games I'm playing right now that I am extremely passionate about.
You loaded it up, and you went, "This isn't Street Fighter VI. Get this out of here."
Garbage.
It's good. I think if you have time, this would be well worth your time. And I just don't have the time to devote to something like this.
Yeah.
But basically, it is a turn-based strategy game where you are controlling a sprite. There's three characters that you can choose, and each one has a different origin story and powers. And they act as like the leader for your army, right? And they have different spells that they can cast during combat. But you're walking around this map, and I played through two of the openings for these characters. They both kind of started the same, like they're wandering this war-torn region, and you find a house and there's supplies there. You find a town, and then you get into some settlement building type stuff. So you can find a town, and you can invest the gold and resources that you're finding out in the world back in the town to get like a blacksmith or a trading post.
It's hexes.
Yes,
yeah.
It is.
Somebody who knows a lot about strategy games is going to have to tell me sometime why hex-based battles are good, because I cannot fucking stand them.
Can I tell you something?
Sure, go for it.
I wasn't crazy about the combat.
Yeah.
Maybe I just was bad, but...
Always a possibility.
I reached the end of the first, what I would say, like, chapter or phase or whatever with each of these two characters. And you are fighting monsters and stuff as you're making your way, like, through the path that leads you to, like, a boss. And with each of them, by the time I got there, like, my army was whittled down to basically nothing.
Yikes.
And there were occasional places that I would see, like, a tent or something. It was like I could recruit a soldier to join me, but I was never like I would just get wiped every time, and I didn't see a way to like grind out stuff because it's like once I cleared the enemies from this portion of the map, they were just gone.
Can I ask you a quick question? Did either one of you ever play Heroes of Might and Magic?
Nope. No, I know that this is supposed to be like an homage.
This is basically a throwback to that.
Yeah. I was reading that some of the reviews, and it's just I don't know. I felt like okay, if I stuck with this, I could probably get there. I just don't know if I want to take the time to do that right now. So I thought it was good, but
yeah, it's gonna look.
I'm not that super crazy about the hex combat. I much prefer like a grid.
Sure.
And I don't know. Like, it just, I played it and then I thought about it for a second. Like, I only played it for 1 hour. Do I want to play it for another hour?
Sure.
I was like, no, not right now. So I got my $15 back that I spent on it. And then Bobby and I made a really stupid decision together today.
Yeah, maybe one of the worst.
I gotta hear about this.
We bought Rust because it's on sale.
Okay. All right. Never mind. I don't need to hear about this anymore. I'm good.
We haven't played it yet.
Yeah, we haven't played it.
That'll be a fright. Maybe, you know what, Bobby? Let's keep that stream under 2 hours.
Yeah, I'm thinking that might be a return.
Yeah. I don't even know if I want to play it. I might just return it.
Here's the thing. I know people that like Rust really like Rust, and it makes for some very funny content to watch, mm-hmm. like people just get completely dicked over. But I don't know how much I want to be dicked over. And I feel like I'm a sucker. I'm a target because I'm going to want to build shit. I'm going to be all about having this base. And then I would be paranoid.
While you're gone, someone's going to come and tear you.
Like, I couldn't. I already have enough anxiety in the real world. I don't need it there.
Yeah, so I don't know. I might just return it without opening it. We'll see.
Yeah, I think I'm already thinking that maybe we got... Like, I would much rather probably return Rust and pick up Songs of Conquest myself.
Yeah. Yeah, dude, I do not want to discourage anyone from playing it themselves. It just didn't feel like the right time, considering how much fucking Street Fighter I still want to play. And other games that I have to play, like Zelda, for example. Haven't finished that yet.
Yeah, same.
If I played like 80 hours of that game, still two of the temples left and the final boss.
I only have one temple left, so I feel good that I'm ahead of you, kind of.
Yeah. But yeah, it's mainly been Street Fighter still. I adore that game. It's now my second most played game on Steam, next to Elden Ring. And I could see going past that because it is so easy to just hop in, fight a few matches. That's been it for me. What say we run through this casual report real quick?
While you're getting that pulled up, I just want to say really quick, Steam Summer Sale, the Kingdom game I mentioned, everything else that they've done is incredibly discounted right now. You can get two Kingdoms for like $3.
Oh, you can actually get a discount on a Steam Deck right now, up to 20%. That's true.
Pretty good.
It's a good deal. I want to start with this story. It just kind of feel good. And then we can do the Xbox stuff. So the Terraria dev, because I thought I read something about like they were like this is the last update forever for Terraria. But it turns out that game just keeps selling so well. Let's see. I have a quote here from the lead person for it. After 12 years, the game still sells like hotcakes. There's so much demand, it makes it hard to move on. And that has to be such a good feeling as a creator to like make something that has endured and is like still this popular. And I think that's really cool. I think that's
it is. I mean, I like the way you phrase that, suffering from success in your headline there. Cause it is.
It's also,
I'd like to build a new game. Mm-hmm. I'd like to do a new thing. It's the game has sold so well. We have money to basically do any new thing that we want to do.
But people still keep playing Terraria.
You feel beholden to that thing, and you're like, well, I can't. I guess we got to keep making more stuff for this.
Yeah, who's the developer? Because I wondered the same thing, if the same thing would happen with Stardew Valley, you know, because that game still like persists.
Yeah,
and is insanely popular. He's making a whole new game. He's making the Haunted Chocolatier.
I forgot what that name was, but yeah,
I can't wait for that shit, man.
Yeah, I'll play whatever that dude puts out next because Stardew's incredible. But
Bobby, that's not in the news. You need to take that down.
I am taking it right now.
Okay.
I'm going to refund that shit.
We Bought Rust is a bad news story, and also one I don't want associated with me. I didn't buy Rust. I don't need people thinking I did that.
What's wrong with you, Chase?
Well, many things, but not that I bought Rust. One of the few things that's not my fault. So, Johnny, what's this big news story that you got to share with us?
So the FTC came I've heard in. Of them. Yeah, Federal Trade Commission stepped in to say, wait a minute, with this Microsoft acquisition of Activision Blizzard. And
this is after the UK already said, hey, let's wait on
this. Yeah, after that one specific branch of the UK came in and said, nah. So I pulled all these bullet points you see, except for this first quote is from this IGN article. But basically, the main part of the FTC's case is content and exclusivity is designed to push Game Pass and therefore harm competitors like Sony. It didn't mention much about harm to consumers, though, which is really like what I would think the main concern would be, right? Mm-hmm. Like if you are interceding to stop a, you know, monopolistic or, you know, something like that, that like you should be thinking about how is this going to impact the people actually buying the product? Not
well, and it seems like maybe it's like the cascading effect of how does this affect the other major players here,
right?
Sony and other stuff, and then if that's a problem, then it would trickle back down to the consumers. I wish the governmental body would say talk about the consumers a little bit more rather than the other big corporation. But I get your point on that. Another little note here. This is like, it's not necessarily the FTC coming in and immediately stopping this. It is almost like a slowdown tactic.
Yeah, it's like let's take a. Well, also the deal has to close by the 18th, I think, or they have to renegotiate the entire thing, and I think Activision gets like. Yeah. At least $1 billion.
Yeah, there's something like, oh, you've been stringing us along so much that we get something out of this.
Yeah, well, it's written into their agreement.
Totally.
Close by such and such date.
Because Activision can't just be on the line forever. Like you have to actually buy them or not buy them. Even if somebody like the FTC comes in and says, whoa, slow down. That doesn't matter to their contract.
Let's think about this.
But the thing I've heard and read is that, you know, even after the merger happens, the FTC could still go back in and say, well, we determined this is a monopoly and we need to break this up. But it's so much harder to determine that when everything has already mixed together. So this is kind of them stalling a little bit for time to get more of that information and untangle more of that stuff before it gets even further tangled up where they feel like they really can't do anything. Even if legally they could, it just is much more difficult.
There's a lot of legal jargon tied into that shit that's way above my head. But what I've been enjoying mostly is just some of the downright pettiness that's come from this.
And also just like the talking out of two sides of your mouth shit that's going on, where Sony on one hand is talking to the quote unquote gamers and what the concerns they say publicly are to that audience are much privately different from the concerns that they talk about in their own internal emails.
Yeah, that is my favorite thing about situations like this. Like stuff that's found in discovery and then is made public. Because there's been some juicy little tidbits that have come out of this.
Hit us up. What have we got?
Guys, the console wars are over.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah,
Xbox good. Says so. They said they lost. And I have to imagine this is like trying to say, well, how can we, you know, we're last place.
Microsoft's we lost the console war. Yeah, absolutely. Like, this is them... You know, we're just trying to put our billions and billions and billions of dollars. We're just trying to scratch and claw our way back up to something even, right? Because Sony's got such a big lead on us. Nintendo, oh my God, have you seen Nintendo? They're fucking monsters out there. We can't compete with
them. They are getting their dicks kicked in. Like, let's not.
Sure.
Yeah, absolutely.
Let's not, like, I mean, it's not. They're not wrong. They're fucking getting smashed. If it was just
Xbox, if Xbox was its own entity that has existed since 2001 mm-hmm. and not a branch of Microsoft, like that on its own kind of like
that context matters, like, of yes, you're a losing proposition, but you're also a corporation that could easily buy Sony and Nintendo and have money left over if you could also to.
You have afforded to have this losing thing for decades now.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. I'm not saying
that what they're saying is not to your point. I'm saying
I think
it's true statement.
I think it is true. Absolutely. Because they have certainly stumbled in Japan and other Asian territories and even European territories. They haven't been the best. Like Nintendo and Sony mopped the floor with them in most of those territories. So I would say overall that certainly they are, I guess if you wanted to say they're in last place now, I could understand that, even though it's still weird with Nintendo because they're like always kind of off, they're off on their own doing their own thing. It is just weird the way that they're trying to position themselves to the American government here.
Yeah. Microsoft also says they expect PlayStation's next console to release in 2028. And yeah, we're about halfway through this gen.
Yeah. I mean, that kind of, I don't know, that kind of makes sense, I guess, right? Like,
It's between last 5 and 9 years.
Say, oh, we have a 10-year console cycle, and we never really made 10. I guess kind of we did, because it's not like there's a bunch of PS5 exclusives out there other than Final Fantasy 16 that people Street Fighter are all that came excited
to
PS4. About.
There's still lots of games coming to PS4 because it has a huge install base. Through some, I think this was the one that, like, they used Sharpie on the documents.
Yeah.
And people were able to easily tell.
Oh, like they put like a little extra half circle where the hurricane was going, just so people would think, okay, I got you. Yep. Yeah.
But we are able to find out that The Last of Us Part 2 and Horizon Forbidden West cost $220 and $212 respectively to produce. That's a lot of fucking money.
It is a lot of money. That one seems weird to me of how they learned that, because I don't understand this part, so maybe you can elucidate me on this. But like, where's all the Sony shit coming from? Because like, this is the FTC looking into Microsoft, right? So
they have to look into Sony, because Microsoft is airing their dirty laundry on Sony. Sony has absolutely.
Yeah, but Microsoft doesn't have the thing, Sony's internal emails. Is Sony suing them or something? Is Sony doing something? Sony is using
money from Microsoft to buy deals of exclusivity that garner Microsoft out, where the tables are very different from a line of work where Microsoft is giving Sony money from things, and then Sony's using that money to garner deals. So the whole thing is, like, when you start to look at what their operational cost is, what they're asking for like terms and lengths on games to remain with them, it's about their fluidity of influx of cash. So they can prove, hey, if we don't have this, you'll see where our bottom line would be impacted. Our games cost this much to make first party. We bank on these things here. Like, that's where we come from.
I guess I get that, but like, it's more of like the legal stuff of did Sony's emails get subpoenaed or something?
Yeah,
is that
totally.
Something that they had to give through discovery?
Jim Ryan and Phil were emailing each other.
Yeah.
Sure. But like, then they have like emails, not like that was between somebody at Xbox and somebody at Sony. So I understand that part.
Well,
but...
I think a lot of this came out in the European cases.
Yeah.
And so I don't know if like they have access to, I assume they got all that stuff because it was publicly available.
But I'm like, PlayStation doesn't necessarily want these emails coming out.
No,
their own internal emails. So no, if it's not just a problem that Microsoft has with the FTC, I'm failing to see where Sony comes in to this, where somebody can say, because well, let's grab Sony's emails.
So you can see what they're doing, because they're basically they're trying to block something, and their subpoenas on what their deals or what they're trying to do are coming into question, because Sony is now going to other areas. Like the whole thing in the UK or wherever it was, like that was largely because of, they said, cloud computing here. Sony's talking about
on trial here.
That's true, but you don't, I mean, dude, this is not out of line for, this is how courts work. Like if there's multiple parties involved, like they can subpoena whatever the fuck they want to for purposes of their
Right, but why, I guess why is Sony a party? Like Sony's not the one because under the microscope Sony's here.
Because the only one pushing back on it. NVIDIA and Nintendo have already signed the contracts to allow this to go through. They don't care.
Yeah. Sony, still, like Sony would have to willingly give up those emails.
No, they're not willingly. If they're subpoenaed, they don't have a choice.
I guess I just don't see why they're subpoenaed, though.
I'm sure we could find the legality.
Yeah.
I mean, but like,
maybe this podcast is not the best.
We don't need to worry about it anymore. I'm still struggling to see why a thing that, hey, Microsoft might be in trouble for doing a monopoly, that Sony then has to give up their emails if they're not involved in said monopoly.
Because Sony's also making a lot of money in this whole shit, too, with this whole point.
Yeah. Speaking of making a lot of money, Call of Duty worth quite a bit, and PlayStation made over $800 million in 2021. So, yeah, I can understand why, you know, maybe they would want to stop this deal from going through. But also, in an email from Jim Ryan, shortly after Microsoft announced its intent to acquire Activision Blizzard, he said, "I'm pretty sure we will continue to see Call of Duty on PlayStation for many years to come." So, yeah, kind of expressing like, you know, they'd be fine if the deal went through. So, and he also has admitted that he doesn't. He's publicly said, you know, he's not a fan of Starfield's exclusivity. He admitted he doesn't think it's anti-competitive. So saying, like Bobby said, talking out of both sides of your mouth, which is, you know, to be expected from heads of corporations, right? And we also learned that PlayStation was actually toying with the idea of buying exclusive rights to Starfield, and that was one of the things that made them buy ZeniMax. And surprise, surprise, Elder Scrolls 6 is a long ways off.
This last one you have here, I think, is one of the more interesting ones.
Which one?
The exclusivity deals. That it's not that they don't
like them. Yeah.
Well, that, but also the fact that there's now a lot of very publicly agreed upon, okay, you can keep this part of Activision Blizzard on these other platforms, and people who work within Bethesda are upset that their game will not be on other platforms. And I think that they're feeling very frustrated from what they've shared in some of these findings, is that there's people who are now saying, well, why wouldn't Bethesda? And I think that was even brought up as like a counterpoint from Sony. Mm-hmm. Well, hey, you're doing it for these. Why won't you do it for those games? Like, why won't you give us Starfield or whatever it would be, Elder Scrolls, on that platform? Like, why only keep these games exclusive to Xbox and not these? And that's where people on, like, internally on Bethesda are like, yeah, we want our games on that platform as well.
Yeah, of course. You, like, as the maker of the game, you want as many people to play it as possible.
For sure.
So, yeah, it's, I don't know, it's always interesting when usually closely guarded things come out like this, and we see, you know, what they really think, because it's there's
wild a way to that see these games journalists at the court for this.
Yeah. That's crazy. You know, we, I mean,
they've done that before a very long time ago. Like that was one of the things on the Game Boys to Men from the Jeff Gerstmann show, where he brought on his friend Glenn Rubenstein, and he worked for the San Francisco Chronicle as like their video game guy, because he was the one who wrote a letter to them saying, I can write video game stuff for you, and then became like a columnist for him. He was called in at one point to like be a expert witness against, I think it was against Sega, maybe. Can't remember exactly who it was against, but it's very funny of like, yes, this the game journalist here who's got this extensive expert knowledge, who's basically just like a 15-year-old kid, is now somebody on the stand. And we're a little bit past that now. Yeah. But yeah, like you absolutely could bring on some games journalists to talk about, I guess, like a more consumer style part of this. By the way, I was looking it up a little bit, and you know, Jim Ryan did have a video deposition, and part of that is that Sony is talking to the FTC about, okay, why this is anti-competitive and why it's bad for Sony and bad for everybody. And as part of that discovery, that's how they got their emails of, okay, hey, you want to talk to us and tell us how bad Microsoft is? Give us your emails that you might not want to show us, but we're going to get the whole story out of you if you're willingly coming out here to say that Microsoft shouldn't get this thing. Well, put up or shut up. We need to see those emails. So that's how that stuff came out. I am now satisfied with that.
Well, thank God.
Yeah,
I didn't make sense to me why this stuff was coming out.
It's fucking court jargon, dude. It's everything. It's all fucking weird.
I know, but if I have to go to court for something, they don't just take your emails for no reason.
Depends on what is being.
Yeah, they absolutely could.
Yeah,
like I've been in a corporate world. I've not had it happen to me, but there's been people, mm-hmm. and I've been in the room where decisions were made. Hey, your phone, we are taking your phone, and we get to legally take your phone from you because you did something with work on it. Right, and they get to go through everything.
Like, there has to be something connected, though. Like if they
and there is like here too. They're
the drug ring that we have going on through the casual hour. Then I could see them saying, "Well, we need all of Bobby's emails. He's associated with the casual hour." But if it's me killing a guy, I don't know. Then it's like, we don't need to look at Bobby's emails. Who the fuck is Bobby?
I think it just depends on.
I mean, Xbox could also say like, "Hey, they're building a defense against this. We're going to basically bring conversations from Sony. Certain things will be redacted out of privacy or whatever it might be." Like that's how this kind of happened
poorly redacted documents that show what the budget was.
And that's Xbox pulling emails that they had with Sony, and we're getting emails here that are a Sony person to another Sony person that Microsoft would have never seen or heard of. And so I was trying to figure that part out. But if Sony is making claims that is going to the FTC as a witness, more or less in this, or an expert, or however they want to detail it, then you can grab those emails. That makes more sense to me.
It's just to my mind's court. Like they can ask for whatever the fuck they want, it seems, and get whatever. Like there's this weird shit, but hey, that works. The FTC said they want to see it. That makes complete sense.
Yeah.
Sony has to show their shit, Johnny, and they did not show it as well as they thought they did. They hid it right under our noses. With a sharp edge.
So the point is, this is probably all still going to go through. It's really more just making it a pain in the ass for Microsoft. From everything that I've heard, I still personally think this is maybe a bad deal in the long run, and I think Sony's internal emails talk about that. Where, you know, yes, we still think we'll have Call of Duty. It's like that's not even really the problem. The problem is this kind of cloud gaming stuff is the stuff that the UK governmental agency was talking about, that Microsoft's like, I don't know what you're talking about. We don't even do cloud gaming. It's like that you might not do it necessarily now, but that's definitely a plan for your future. And that's going to be the future of games. Mm. And if you hold the big publishers that would be able to pull something like that off, and leave everybody else to grab the scraps, then that absolutely is anti-competitive. And I don't know. We talk about I can go back to the argument that we've made before that Game Pass absolutely is the best deal in video games right now, and probably will continue to be for a while longer. But like what we've seen with something like Netflix, like what we've seen more recently with something like Twitter, even though that's kind of a different industry, it's like these things eventually get to a point where they're big enough that they don't have to try as hard. They don't have the competition there. And then they just end up getting worse and more expensive at the same time. And I think that's potentially could lead to a lot of developers being out of jobs. I mean, you see what's happening with Embracer Group recently, where Embracer Group bought up all of these properties, bought up all of these studios, just bought everything. And just recently, they're like, hey, we're losing a lot of money on this. We gotta cut a bunch of jobs. We gotta cut a bunch of studios. And you're seeing a lot of people go out of work because they were embraced and now they're let go. Because what the Embracer Group kind of really wanted in the long run was probably just the IP, because that is the stuff you could sell to somebody else or rent to somebody else and make your money back on that. Whereas a bunch of overhead for all these people that you hired and now found redundant, that's where the real costs are. And I think you could get to a similar situation with Game Pass, where Microsoft's amassed so much stuff that then they start just cutting things. And the things that they cut might not be a big deal to millions of people, but could be a really big deal to tens, hundreds, thousands of people.
I saw a ton of indie studios shut down too. I think there's just like the stakes have not been higher for studios, regardless of who has them right now. And it's scary as shit, but especially when there's buying power in an area where you're already losing identity. And you are now part of it. Like I Campo Santo, like I can't fucking believe we lost that game. Like that game just disappeared after Firewatch, like what could have been, right?
Yeah, that studio gets acquired by Valve and those people just kind of dissipate into Valve in other places. And I'm sure they're all doing great work on a bunch of cool Valve stuff. But also in the Valley of the Gods looked like a really neat thing. And I really wish we got to see what it was, but we never will because it disappeared. Right.
But I think that it'll be interesting to see what happens. Microsoft, to the points being made across the board here, has a war chest of money to keep these studios, I think, under their wings a bit longer than normal. But at the same time, we don't know what that's going to look like from competition, where things are at. Like I definitely value, I benefit from the value of Game Pass myself. Like we talk about it on here a lot. I'm going to continue to invest in that service. Like I think it's fantastic, but I don't disagree with what we've covered. I think that there's a risk to it. I think that it could be a dangerous spot for smaller studios, especially because visibility, as we just talked about a minute ago, for those shutdowns, your game doesn't get seen. You don't hit a certain quota. That's it for you. You're done.
Microsoft corporate or even Xbox corporate, if you want to go lower than that, they have priorities that they're looking to hit, and their priorities might be different than Double Fine's priority, a subsidiary company now under Xbox, under Microsoft. So if somebody at the top of Microsoft makes a big decision, that could affect Double Fine in a way that it wouldn't have affected them if they were an independent company.
I mean, a small indie studio could not bounce back from the reviews and reception of Redfall. Where Microsoft can put a game out like Redfall and people are lining up for Starfield. That would have killed a small studio. Mm-hmm. And it just would have been done.
I mean, it nearly killed a big studio with Cyberpunk. Like the way that game came out and the way it ruined the credibility of CD Projekt Red. And they are slowly, slowly, slowly gaining that back little by little with updates and DLC of what they've done to Cyberpunk. But it's a weird situation and it's a weird time. Like every industry is going through this consolidation, it seems. And I guess like interest rates were super low, so like the borrowing of money is a lot cheaper, so you could go out and spend money on things, and then having the assets was more valuable than having the cash on hand. And I know interest rates are starting to go back up, so I don't know if that's going to change this consolidation stuff. It probably still is going to keep going on for a while longer. But it makes financial sense for these companies to keep getting bigger and bigger. And that's not necessarily, it keeps making sense for them anyway. And I think it's probably going to end up in a rawer deal for people like you and me, as we just want to play the cool video games that come out.
Totally. Johnny, thanks for putting that together. It's a fucking weird situation. We're not lawyers or industry pundits in that regard.
Or economists experts of any kind.
Take our fucking words with nothing, because that's what they are.
A couple of bachelor degrees among the three of us, and that's about it. Johnny's education wasn't even real.
That's true. it was part of an acquisition. So we've had a fun week already for everybody here that has been paying attention. Here's our links to the things we're talking about. We did a classic on Casual Mondays. We went back to Monster Train, had a really good time playing that game. That game continues to be very good. We put up our quick look for Aliens Dark Descent. That is also a game that surprises me quite a bit. I went back to it over the weekend, had a lot of fun. We have told you about the games we've been playing tonight on episode 332. And Chase alluded to it, but we have a quick look going up sometime tomorrow. I got to get a few more edits done on it. AEW Fight Forever will be going up on our YouTube page as well. And Johnny and I will continue to head to hell on Fridays until maybe Baldur's Gate 3 or Exo Primal. But we're trying to get Johnny through the story of Diablo 4. And or five or four. Sorry. I don't know why I'm thinking five.
Diablo 5. Damn, Bobby. Damn. You got the hookup.
Yes.
That wasn't even in the FTC emails.
I was thinking level 50 went to 5. I don't know why.
I get you.
But yes,
honest mistake.
We will get you where you need to go, Johnny, right there on Fridays.
Great.
Chase, what do you got going on?
Unfortunately, nothing much. Pierce is sick. RIP Pierce. He's not dead. He's just sick. So we're not able to record the newest episode of Pilot Program, which is going to be on the Bear, which bugs me quite a bit because I don't want to spoil too much, but I really liked that first episode of the Bear, and I would love to watch the other 17 episodes of the Bear as soon as possible. And I can't do that until we record the episode. So that's probably not getting recorded until next week. Which means I have probably another week of not being able to watch more of the Bear, which makes me very sad. But that episode
Angry
will go
up. Bear.
Yeah. For now, though, you can go and listen to an old episode that we did just last week. We put out our episode on RuPaul's Drag Race in time for Pride Month. You can find that at shows.acast.com/pilotprogram, or you can listen to the other 12 episodes that we've made previously, which are all very good.
Nice. We will be back live Friday night with Diablo 4. Come hang out with Johnny and myself, and check out our YouTube page and Chase's other stuff he's got going on. A lot of cool reasons to hang out with us. Johnny, thanks for the news segment. We'll talk to you all very soon.